your suffering, your hardship. He said, rejoice. There's a reason to rejoice. Rejoice and be glad. For your reward is in heaven and is coming real soon. It's great. It's great, saints. Hold on. For in the same way they persecuted the prophet who were before you. Saints, hold on to your blessing. Jesus says, you're blessed. You are blessed. Let no one tell you anything else. Amen? So, saints, be blessed in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen. How many of you thank God for his word? Thank God for his truth. I want to pick up a lot of what I'm going to. You can give the Lord a hand clap of praise. We thank him for his blessings and his provisions. Hallelujah. Much of what Elder Waldron has brought to us this morning ties in with what I'm about to go into. So, coincidence, I guess. Amen. How many of you thank God for his spirit? Turn with me, if you would, to the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 1. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Hallelujah. Thank God for his spirit. Thank God for his word. How many of you thank God for his goodness? Has he been good to you? I know we say, God is good. And you say, oh, all the time. We used to say it all the time. But how many of you understand God is good? Amen. Every day his mercies are renewed. Are they not? We thank God for his mercy, for his goodness, for his grace. For had it not been for his grace, guess what, saints? You wouldn't be here. Amen. I wouldn't be here. But God is continually good to us, and we thank him for it. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, we'll start at verse 1. Amen.
Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and Timothy, our brother.
Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by whose will? God's will. That's key. Amen. Nobody can appoint themselves an apostle. Right? You can desire the office of a bishop. And you will. If God's dealing with you, he has a calling on your life, you'll have the desire to operate as an overseer in the church, but you can't just desire the office of an apostle. Jesus has to call you out. God has to ordain you for it. Amen. It doesn't happen on accident. Keep coming from a bishop. Notice this.
To the church of God, which is at Corinth.
So the church of God, which is at Corinth, who's writing to the church of God that's at Corinth? Paul. How many of you understand Paul was extremely instrumental in the Christian faith? That Paul was the most important apostle in regards to the Gentile church. You understand that, right? That Paul and Barnabas were appointed as apostles unto the Gentiles. That was what Peter had discussed with Paul about according to the book of Galatians. That even according to what Jesus spoke to Paul, that he would be instrumental in the church, in the gospel being brought to the Gentiles. So you guys understand, he is very vital to our faith. God used him mightily to us. So this person, this apostle that God used mightily, is now speaking to the Corinthian church. Because you keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
With all the saints who are throughout Achaia. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The Father of mercies.
The Father of? How many of you thank God for his mercy? You can't get mercy unless it comes from God. He's the Father of mercies, the originator of mercies. Amen. Thank God for his mercy. God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies. Keep coming. Notice this.
And God of all comfort.
And God of all. That's powerful. And God of all comfort, not worldly comfort, not comfort that just lasts a day, lasts a minute. Father of all godly, heavenly comfort. How many of you thank God for his comfort? Did he not give unto us a comforter? Amen. Christ told us he wouldn't leave us as orphans. He wouldn't leave us fatherless, but he would come unto us. He would comfort us. He would give to us another comforter. Notice this. Keep coming for me, Bishop.
Who comforts us in all our affliction.
Who comforts us in all of our. How many of you guys get afflicted? I know I get afflicted, but as much as I get afflicted, I have a God that is the God of all comfort. As much as I get afflicted in this life, I have somewhere I can go to for refuge. How many of you can testify of that? That there's no affliction, there's no problem, there's nothing you can go through that's bigger than the comfort God has to offer us. Amen? Read that verse for me one more time, Bishop.
Who comforts us in all our affliction.
Who comforts us in some. Who comforts us in half. Who comforts us in all of our affliction. Didn't the scripture say, cast your care upon him? Because you understand that Christ told us in this world you shall have tribulation. How many of you understand that you're not going to be able to escape tribulation? As long as you name the name of Christ, tribulation is something you are going to have to deal with. Amen? So you got to make sure that in this lifetime, you understand that in the midst of tribulation, in the midst of affliction, that God is the God of all comfort. And he'll comfort you in the midst of whatever you're going through. Because if you forget that, what you get is tribulation and no peace. Amen? If you forget that, what you get is affliction and no rest. That's what happens when you get afflicted and forget to pray. You just get afflicted. But when you get afflicted and you take it upon yourself to seek God, to pray, to cast your cares upon him, what happens? You get comforted. Because he's the Father of mercies, the God of all comfort. Amen? Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
So that we will be able to comfort those who are in any affliction.
So that God didn't just want to give you the comforter. He wanted to make you a comforter. You're going through it. Then God comforts you so that. Tell your neighbor, I'm here for you. Listen, you can't do ministry when you don't have peace yourself. You ain't got nothing to offer. When somebody's going through chaos, how are you going to impart peace? That's the reason why Jesus could walk into the disciples and say, peace be unto you. Why? Because he had the peace to impart to them. That's the reason why Jesus could speak to the storm and say, peace, be still. Why? Because he had the peace to impart to it. If you're not getting comforted by the God of all comfort, then when somebody else needs comfort, you can't. How could you possibly help them? You know what happens when people who aren't right with God try to help other people who aren't right with God? Sin. Can I get a witness? What happens when unrighteous pastors try to pastor people that are living in fornication? Fornication happens. That's what happens. Can I get a witness? That's why it's vital that not only you go through afflictions, but that through your afflictions, you learn to seek God so God can provide for you not just what you need to get right with him, but what the body of Christ needs to get right with him. Because as God supplies it to you, you're then capable of supplying it to everyone else. Read that verse for me one more time, Bishop. Notice this.
Who comforts us in all our affliction, so that we will be able to comfort those who are in any affliction. Hallelujah. With the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God.
That's powerful. So that we ourselves will be. Read it for me one more time, Bishop. Powerful verse.
Who comforts us in all our affliction. So that we will be able to comfort those.
So that we will. Well, I don't know what to say. It ain't about whether or not you know what to say. It's whether or not you've allowed God to comfort you. Because if you've allowed God to comfort you, he then will make you able to comfort somebody else. This thing is bigger than us. It has to do with God and our relationship with God. And if you go to the well to drink, God's going to give you water to give to somebody else. Amen? Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
So that we are able to comfort those who are in any affliction.
Who are in? No problem too big for the comfort of God. God's dying to comfort somebody so that you can comfort somebody else. Amen? Tell your neighbor it's about the body. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
With the comfort which we have received ourselves, which we ourselves are comforted by God.
By God. Somebody say godly comfort. That's what God's trying to give. Not carnal comfort. Amen. Godly comfort. Notice this.
For just as the sufferings of Christ are ours in abundance, so also our comfort is abundant through Christ.
Just as the sufferings of Christ are. Oh, this life is tough. The sufferings of Christ are real. The sufferings of Christ are abundant. Not only are Christ's sufferings abundant for us, but what, saints? But the comfort that comes through Christ is also what? So that means the same amount of peace that Christ had while he was enduring the cross is the same type of peace and comfort God wants to supply to us through Jesus, regardless of whatever we're going through. That, yes, saints, the affliction and the tribulation is abundant. But as much as that's abundant, the comfort of God is abundant. Amen? You understand, God has a plan. God has a recipe. God is not just going to hang you out to dry. Amen? He understands human life. He understands what we go through. He's the one who created us, and he understands the comfort that we need in order to get through. And he's able and willing to supply it. Keep coming, Bishop. Notice this.
But if we are afflicted, it is for your comfort and salvation.
But if we are, y'all ready to get deep? This is why you can't be a selfish Christian right here. But if we are, it is for what, saints? Say it a little louder for me. If we are afflicted, it is for. If I am afflicted, it is for. This thing ain't even about you. If you get afflicted, it's for. Read it for me one more time, Bishop.
But if we are afflicted, it is for your comfort and salvation.
For your comfort and your salvation. So what happens to you has an impact on the body of Christ. Sometimes good, but it can be bad depending on how you respond. Amen? Because when somebody is enduring hardships and they display faith and they display righteousness and they display sincerity, what does that do to you? Does it not strengthen you? When somebody is a living testimony of the grace and power of God, what does that do for you? It strengthens you. So while you're going through it and you respond in faith, you then start ministering to the lives of those that are around you without even having to say anything. Just by living righteous, you're inspiring the body of Christ unto salvation. Because at some point, because saints, let's be honest, the word of God in its most powerful form is when it became flesh. Amen? That's why Paul said we don't need recommendation from any man, for ye are our epistles. You are living proof of the word of God. That your lifestyle, your testimony displays what true faith in Jesus is. So while you're enduring a trial, while you're enduring a tribulation, and you go through it as Christ desires you to go through it, you then wind up affecting the lives of those around you. Amen? How many of you understand God wants us all to be saved? Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
Or if we are comforted, it is for your comfort.
So if we're afflicted, it's for your comfort. And if we're comforted, it's for your. It's like no matter what happens, it's happening to bless the lives of those that are around you. How many of you understand that when you realize that the effort you're making to serve God is having an impact on the lives of those around you, how many of you understand it makes you want to keep pressing on? You could be down in the dumps wondering why you got to endure this, why this is the cup you have to drink. But then when somebody comes up and say, hey, brother, hey, sister, I appreciate your faithfulness. It has been a tremendous blessing to me. What does that do for you? And what winds up happening is the body of Christ winds up impacting the lives of those that are around us. We start impacting each other's lives. Because that's the perfect plan. That's why we need the body of Christ. We need the body of Christ. This thing has to be bigger than just head knowledge. It has to be a lifestyle and a demonstration of faith and of a genuine love for God. And when you see what it's really like when it's lived out, it brings you comfort. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
Which is effective in the patient enduring of the same sufferings which we also suffer.
Hallelujah. The same sufferings we're going through are bringing comfort. That's powerful. That's why we gotta, no matter what happens, we just gotta keep pressing, keep living righteous, and understand that we're examples, not just to the world, but one to another. Amen? That while we keep pressing on and serving God, we're impacting each other's lives. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
And our hope for you is firmly grounded, knowing that as you are sharers of our sufferings, so also you are sharers of our comfort.
Powerful. That our hope for you is firmly grounded because Paul understands that you're not just going to share in my sufferings, that as I suffer and keep living righteous, you're also going to be a partaker in my comfort. That because as Christians, we're both going to endure the same type of afflictions, the same type of persecution, that when I'm going through it and I display righteousness, I can offer you the comfort God gave me when it's your turn to go through it. Because to be honest, we're all going through the same thing. You understand we're all on the same journey. We're all trying to get to the same place. We all believe in the same God. We all put faith in the same Christ. We're all going to endure the same trials, same tribulations. There's nothing new under the sun. Amen? We're all going to face the same things, and it's vital that we go through it with the right spirit, receiving the comfort of God so we can impart it to the lives of those that are around us. Keep coming, Bishop. Notice this.
And our hope for you is firmly grounded, knowing that as you are sharers of our suffering, so also are you sharers of our comfort.
Amen.
For we do not want you to be unaware, brethren, of our affliction.
See, notice how Paul's talking. Paul said, I don't even want you to be ignorant of what I'm going through. How many of you understand? That's humility. Because pride in us keeps us from sharing what we're going through. How you doing, brother? I'm blessed, highly favored, praise God, going through hell. Can I get a witness? And while you're enduring the trials of this life, going through all of these things that the enemy is putting onto you, literally having to put up with everything, pressures that's going on in the world. When you are too prideful to admit it, you're not just robbing yourself from comfort. You're robbing the lives of those around you from comfort. Because when other people know what you're going through and you demonstrate true faith, you start ministering to those that are around you. So notice what Paul says. Give me that verse one more time, Bishop.
For we do not want you to be unaware, brethren, of our affliction which came to us in Asia, that we were burdened excessively beyond our strength.
We don't want you to be ignorant of the fact that while we were in Asia, we were excessively beyond our... Who's writing this to the Corinthians? How monumental was Paul in the Christian faith? But Paul, knowing how important he was, knowing he was an apostle, called of God, set apart from birth, amen? Ain't that what he said? Still wrestled with the same thing you and I wrestle with. Read it for me one more time, Bishop.
For we do not want you to be unaware, brethren, of our affliction which came to us in Asia, that we were burdened excessively beyond our strength,
beyond our, even so what, Bishop?
So that we despaired even of life.
So much that we didn't even find hope in life. I don't even want to keep living like this anymore. Paul said, I don't want you, not only
confessed to it, but wanted to make sure that they knew how bad of a state he was in. He said, I don't want you to be ignorant of it, that what I'm enduring right now is some serious stuff. Because you understand, when Paul wrote this, he wrote this from prison. He was in prison for serving Christ. He's writing to them saying, I don't want you to be ignorant that what I'm going through and what I went through in Asia was enough to make me want to go ahead and call it quits. And when you don't testify of the state you're in, when you're not honest with where you're at spiritually, you can't really get true healing. Paul wasn't too prideful to confess, listen, I didn't think I could make it. I got to be honest, I was ready to give up. Not Paul. Listen, if Paul could do it, you could do it. Amen? I'm not saying glorify your problems, because there's a fine line here. But you got to be honest with where you're at. Because if you're not honest with where you're at, you'll never get delivered. Wasn't that true with the Jews? Jesus said unto them, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They said, we have Abraham as our father. We've never been in bondage to any man. Have they ever read the Bible? The Jews were in bondage throughout the whole entirety of the Old Testament. Starting in Egypt, going down to the Philistines, to Babylon, Median Persian Empire, I mean, all through the Bible, even to the time of Christ, the Jews were under the bondage and oppression of the Romans. They said, we have Abraham as our father. We've never been in bondage. Sometimes you just got to admit where you're at and be honest with where you're at so God can heal you, so God can bring you comfort. You got to cast your cares upon God, for he cares for you. Don't act like there's not a problem. Bring your problem to God. Testify of your struggles. This is what Paul was doing. He didn't want them to be ignorant of just how bad off he was. You know why he didn't want them to be ignorant? Because Paul understood that if I was this bad and God delivered me, then I need to tell somebody else about it, because it's going to help somebody else out when they're feeling bad, when they're feeling down in the dump, when they're going through their trial, when they're going through their tribulation. If I can tell them, hey, I was there, it's going to bring them comfort. Because sometimes, saints, let's be honest, it comforts us just to know we're not the only ones. Amen? Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
We had the sentence of death within ourselves, so that we would not trust in ourselves, but in God who raises the dead.
Indeed, we had the sentence of within where? Can you say depressed? Indeed, we had the sentence of death within ourselves. That what, Bishop?
So that we would not trust in ourselves.
So that we would not trust in ourselves. Because you understand, when you're that low, there ain't nothing in yourself that you can trust. Because you feel like dying. But what, Bishop? We didn't trust in ourselves, but did what?
But in God who raises the dead.
Hallelujah. We didn't trust in ourselves, but we put our trust in God, because it just so happens that our God happens to specialize in resurrections. Amen? God is good. God is powerful. There's no affliction too powerful that his comfort can't reach down and bring comfort to. There's no situation stronger than the mercy and comfort of God. And Paul starts off his letter to the Corinthians by letting them know God is the God of all comfort. And regardless of what you endure, he's going to comfort you. Keep coming. Notice this next verse.
Who delivered us from so great a peril of death.
Who delivered us from so great a peril of. Somebody say deliverance. Who delivered us from so great a peril of death. That what, Bishop?
And will deliver us.
And he delivered us from death. He will deliver us. And what?
He on whom we have set our hope.
He on whom we have set our. That what, Bishop? Is that ever?
And he will yet deliver us.
And he will. He has done it. He's doing it, and he'll do it in the future, because God always proves himself to be faithful, that regardless of any circumstance, situation you find yourself in, God is always capable of what? A resurrection. He's always capable of providing deliverance. He's always capable of providing comfort. He's always capable of providing peace. Go on and on down the list. His goodness is inexhaustive. He doesn't run out of supplies. He's not your bank account. Amen? He's not dealing in terms of limitations. He is the eternal God that has an unlimited supply of whatever you need. Notice this. Give me 2 Corinthians 4 and 7. 2 Corinthians 4 and 7. I want to hit a couple things in this letter that Paul points out. Powerful letter. This letter's been on my spirit this week. And really, any part of the word that God is dealing with you about seems to be powerful, doesn't it? Just when the Spirit's involved, how many of you understand it? It's life and peace. The Spirit speaks. 2 Corinthians 4 and 7, notice this.
But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, so that the surpassing greatness of the power will be of God and not from ourselves.
So that the surpassing greatness of power would be from who? And not of who? That's what we got to trust in, saints. That's where I lift my eyes unto the hill, from whence cometh my help. My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. This is what Paul is saying. Your help doesn't come from yourself. Your help always has and always will come from God. That's why we look to God when we need help. Amen. Keep coming. Notice this.
We are afflicted in every way.
We are afflicted in every way. Tell your neighbor, every way. We're afflicted in every single way imaginable. But what, Bishop?
But not crushed.
But not crushed.
Perplexed, but not despairing.
Perplexed, but not despairing. You guys know what despairing means? To be disparaged or despairing means to be without any sense of hope. He's saying we're perplexed. We're stressed. We're burdened down, but we're not without hope. The same way you feel when you're going through it is the same way Paul felt when he was going through it. But Paul made the confession, I die daily. I'm afflicted in all ways, yet I'm not crushed. I'm perplexed, but I'm not despairing. I'm not without hope. What, Bishop? Notice this.
Persecuted, but not forsaken.
I'm persecuted, but I'm not. They might forsake me, but the one that matters never forsakes me. Amen. They might hate me, but the one who's keeping me loves me. Amen. Persecuted, but not forsaken. What, Bishop?
Struck down, but not destroyed.
Struck down, meaning the battle wasn't easy. I wasn't just standing up claiming Jesus, shaming the devil, dancing. You understand, to be struck down in battle means you definitely took some wounds. It definitely wasn't that easy. You got struck down, but you weren't what? Hallelujah. Paul is just being honest about where he was at spiritually. And whether or not we admit it, saints, we've all been there. And when you get there, seek out the brethren for help, for prayer. Seek out the elders for wisdom that you might be ministered to. Because you're not the only one going through it. If Paul wasn't too spiritual to go through it, there's a good chance neither of us are going to be too spiritual to go through it. Christ himself wasn't too spiritual to go through. It's part of the human experience. That's why we have a high priest which can't be touched with the feeling of our infirmities. Amen? Tempted in all points, yet without sin. How many of you understand? Jesus understands the human life because he lived it. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
Always carrying about in the body the dying of Jesus.
Always carrying about in our body the what? Always carrying about in our body the dying to self. That no matter how hard it gets, no matter how perplexed you get, no matter how persecuted you get, you realize that if you don't die to yourself in those emotions, you ain't never going to make it out alive. Keep coming, Bishop. Notice this.
So that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body.
You die to self so Christ can be manifested in your body. That's why you die to self, so Christ can live through you. Because you know You yourself don't have the strength to keep living righteous. But you know Christ had the strength to keep living righteous because he knew no sin. So when you die to yourself and you allow Christ to live through you, you're allowing the one that was made perfect to become the author of your salvation and get you through it without falling. It's powerful. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
For we who live are constantly being delivered over to death for Jesus' sake.
For we who live are. Y'all like, I don't know about constantly being delivered. Listen, as much as you're being constantly delivered over to affliction, God is constantly providing comfort. That's what Paul's getting across, that no matter what you go through, no matter how bad it seems, God has an unlimited amount of comfort to supply to you, that he can get you through it. You'll be clothed and in your right mind. Amen. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
So that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal flesh.
The life of Jesus. We're going through these afflictions so Christ could be manifested in our mortal flesh. Something to think about, is it not? So Christ be formed in us. That's powerful. Keep coming, Bishop. Notice this.
So death works in us, but life in you.
So, hold it. So death, affliction, trial, tribulation is working in us. But while death is working in us, while death is working in me, what's happening to you? Hallelujah. While you're going through it, God's not just putting you through that, allowing you to go through that for no reason. It's not only for your own personal benefit that Christ be formed in you, but it's for the benefit of those around you, because while you're staying strong, God's using your strength, your faithfulness to provide life to the lives of those that are around you. While afflictions are working death in us, it's at the same time working. So while you're dying to yourself, you're providing life for those that are around you. That's powerful. While you're dying, those that God has put in your life are living. While your natural man is dying, their spirit man is growing. Hallelujah. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
But having the same spirit of faith, according to what is written, I believed, therefore I spoke.
Hallelujah.
We also believe, therefore we also speak.
Amen.
Knowing that he who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus.
Hallelujah.
And will present us with you.
Knowing that he that raised the Lord Jesus. See, Paul always understood that no matter what he has going on, he has God. And God will always supply whatever he needs to endure. Keep coming, Bishop. Notice this.
For all things are for your sakes, so that the grace which is spreading to more and more people may cause the giving of thanks to abound to the glory of God.
That's powerful. For all things that I'm going through are for your sakes. Ain't that what he said? Yeah. All things are for. This is what Paul's trying to get across to them, that everything he endures, has the way he responds, has a much greater impact than on just himself. Because you got to understand, if Paul makes up in his mind that he's going to walk away, what's that going to do for everybody he won to Christ? It ain't going to help him. Amen? But when Paul consistently lives righteous, what does that do for those that are in his life that he's impacted? It causes them to want to continue to live righteous. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
Therefore, we do not lose heart, but though our outer man is decaying,
hallelujah,
yet our inner man is being renewed day by day.
Hallelujah.
For momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory far beyond all comparison.
Hallelujah.
While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Is that the end of that chapter?
Yeah.
Go ahead and give me chapter 5 real fast. Is everybody still with me? How many of you understand? His word is rich. I want to encourage you that according to the leading of the Spirit, go back through and read 2 Corinthians 1 and 4 and the beginning of 5. And there's a lot of deep things that are said, but for time's sake, some of them we just need to sit on and meditate on. Amen? Because they're powerful. Some chapters, you feel like every verse you read, you just need to not even say nothing. Just think on it. Notice this. Chapter 5, beginning at verse 1. Notice how he starts off.
For we know that if the earthly tent, which is our house, is torn down, we have a building from God.
We know that if we die, it doesn't end there. Paul's saying that's the difference between us and everybody else. We don't fear the one who can kill the body. We fear the one who can kill, destroy both body and soul in hell. He's saying we don't fear what man can do. If this body dies, we got another body waiting for us. Amen? Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
A house not made with hands.
Hallelujah.
Eternal in the heavens.
Hallelujah.
For indeed, in this house we groan, longing to be clothed with our dwelling from heaven. Hallelujah. Inasmuch as we, having put it on, will not be found naked. For indeed, while we are in this tent, we groan, being burdened, because we do not want to be unclothed, but to be clothed.
Notice that. For while we are in this tent, we do what? We groan. Because why? Because we're burdened with life. How many of you go through that? That while you're living this life, I say it all the time. We all say it. Man, I just hope Jesus comes back. I just want to get out of it. And a lot of times, it's not even a declaration of faith as much as it is a declaration of I just want to escape. Can I get a witness? We say, I just want the Lord to come back. Like, it's not always a declaration of faith. It's like spiritual suicide. I want the Lord to come back so I can end this, but I'm not going to kill myself. But I want this to be over. Are we being too honest? Do you really want, or are you really right enough with God that you really want him to come back right now? Because most of the times when you say that, you're really not where you need to be spiritually. You're like, I just need Jesus to come back. It's like, girl, if he came back, would you make it? Boy, if he came back, I mean, do you? Can I get a witness? What, bro, are we being too honest today? We groan because, y'all ready for that? I'm about to blow your mind with this deep revelation right here. Saints, life is tough sometimes. Life was tough for Paul. Life was tough for Jesus. Life's going to be tough for you. Life's going to be tough for me. But as long as life's tough, we understand that this is what Paul's getting across. The fullness of our life is not this. We got another body once this body's done. Amen? And while we're here, while we're going through everything, we're going through it for a reason. That's what Paul's getting across while he's talking to the Corinthians. He's saying, I'm going through all of this affliction. I'm going through all this suffering. But I'm not going through it all for no reason. I'm going through it for your sakes. And he's trying to get across to them the same thing. When you're going through it, when you're enduring it, it's not for no reason. It's for your own spiritual good, but it's also for the good of those that are around you. Notice this. Give me Philippians 1 real fast. Philippians 1 and 21. Paul's kind of saying the same thing in Philippians 1 and 21. And I'm going to come back to something in 2 Corinthians. But is everybody still with me? Philippians 1 and 21. Notice this.
For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain.
For me, to live is Christ. While I'm alive, it's going to be for Christ. But to die, let's be honest, it'd be gain. Amen? When Paul wrote to the Philippians, he wrote from them while he was in prison. That's a common thing. Paul wasn't just sitting in prison being lazy. Paul was sitting in prison getting right with God and ministering to the saints. We wouldn't even have a New Testament had this guy not been in prison. That's something to think about. Amen? So it's amazing how much stuff you can get done spiritually when you ain't got nothing else to do. Sometimes we're too busy to get saved. Too busy to work on your relationship with God. Amen? Well, I think we're all guilty of that from time to time. But as long as you're too busy to work on your relationship with God, that means, because let's be honest, you're going to go through affliction. You're never too busy for affliction, but you get too busy for a relationship with God. You get too busy. Listen, you're never too busy for affliction, but you'll be too busy to work on your relationship with God. You know what that means? If we're too busy to work on your relationship with God while you're going through affliction, you're not going to be able to receive the comfort you need to make it through because you're too busy. You got to make time for God. Amen? Give me that verse one more time, Bishop. 1 and 21.
For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain.
Hallelujah. Keep on coming. Notice this.
But if I am to live on in the flesh, this will mean fruitful labor for me.
If I am to live on in the flesh, it's for what? It's for a purpose. It's for labor. It's to bring forth fruit. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
And I do not know which to choose.
I don't know which one to choose. Whether to stay with you or to go on and be with Christ. Because we all, when we're going through dilemmas, say, well, I just want this to be over. I'm ready to go be with Jesus. But we got to understand that while we're here, we got a purpose. While we're here, we got a job to do. While we're here, we got some things we have to take care of. Keep coming for me, Bishop. Notice this.
But I am hard-pressed from both directions, having the desire to depart and to be with Christ.
I'm hard-pressed from both directions. Notice this.
Having the desire to depart and be with Christ, for that is very much better.
Amen.
Yet to remain on in the flesh is more necessary for your sake.
Wait, to remain on in the flesh is more necessary for me. Ain't that what he said? It's better for me that I go through this. God's saying, Paul, I called you to do more than just minister to you. I called you to minister to the lives of those that are around you. And you can't affect the lives of those that are around you if you're not here. So instead of me bringing you back now, I'm going to leave you there because it's better for those people I placed in your life that you go through this and that you live righteous. Because it's going to do more for their salvation than it will be if I take you on home. We got to understand, saints, and live with this mentality that regardless of what I'm going through, that while I'm enduring, while I'm pressing, while I'm being faithful, I'm being fruitful. Because you got to understand that as long as you're living righteous and enduring everything and testifying about it and being honest about what you go through, God is using you to bring faith, love, hope. He's using what you're going through to work on the lives of the body of Christ. And I thank God for using me. I thank God for using you. Because I can't tell you, saints, I understand life gets hard. But every time you're enduring it and you're displaying faithfulness, it's a blessing to me. Even if I don't ever get the chance to tell you, it's a blessing to me. When you testify and you constantly stay faithful to God, faithful to the house of God, faithful to being righteous, it's a blessing to me. Can I get a witness? How many of you understand that? That it motivates you when the body of Christ continues to press, continues to fight. Saints, we got to keep pressing. We got to keep fighting. We got to keep on living righteous because ain't nobody else looking out for us but us. Spiritually, ain't nobody else looking out for my salvation but you. Can I get a witness? I need you. We all need each other. Let's keep pressing. Let's keep striving. Notice this. 2 Corinthians chapter 7. A couple verses here and I'm finished. Thank God for his word. Amen. 2 Corinthians 7. We'll start with verse 1. Just a few verses. I want to point this out here with the Apostle Paul.
Therefore, having these promises, beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all defilement of flesh and spirit, perfecting holiness in the fear of God.
How many of you understand true, perfect holiness is spiritual, purifying of the spirit, and purifying of the flesh. It's inward and outward. Amen? Keep coming, Bishop. Notice this.
Make room for us in your hearts. We wronged no one. We corrupted no one. We took advantage of no one. I do not speak to condemn you, for I have said before that you are in our hearts to die together and to live together. Great is my confidence in you. Great is my boasting on your behalf. I am filled with comfort. I am overflowing with joy in all our affliction.
Notice this. I am filled with comfort. I am overflowing with in the middle of everything. Because remember, Paul, when he wrote this, he was in prison. He's writing to them, talking about his afflictions, talking about how much he despaired even of life. And now he's telling them that in the midst of my affliction, I have comfort and I have joy. Notice what he goes on to say, why he has it. This is a blessing.
For even when we came into Macedonia, our flesh had no rest.
When we came to Macedonia, our flesh had no what? Somebody say, we were weary. When we came to Macedonia, our flesh had no rest. Keep coming. Notice this.
But we were afflicted on every side.
We were afflicted on. Tell your neighbor, every side. Afflicted on every side. Notice this.
Conflicts without.
Conflicts with. Afflicted on every side. We had conflicts from everything that was outside of our control. Things that were outside of the church. We had conflicts without and what?
Fears within.
Fears. Paul, don't be so honest. He hadn't given us a spirit of fear. You're right. But sometimes we get afraid. Okay, wow. Can I get a witness? He didn't give you a spirit of fear, but sometimes you get afraid. Listen, you're only doing wrong when you stay in that state and don't go to God for comfort and peace. You're going to have feelings like that come up. Amen? But you're only in the wrong when you dwell on them and allow those feelings and emotions to consume you spiritually to where you start disobeying God. These thoughts are going to come, but you have to arrest them and take them captive. He said, conflicts without, fears within, and what, Bishop?
But God, who comforts the depressed.
But God, who comforts the depressed. That's powerful. Conflicts without, fears within, but God who comforts the depressed, did what, Bishop?
Comforted us by the coming of Titus.
Comforted us, because you understand that's what God does. When you're dealing with fears, when you're dealing with depression, and you go to God, God will comfort you. I was dealing with it, but God comforted us by the coming of Titus. Keep coming, Bishop, notice this.
And not only by his coming, but also by the comfort with which he was comforted in you. Now, as
I was comforted, not just because he came, but I was comforted by Titus because when he came, he told me something. What did he say, Bishop?
As he reported to us your longing, your mourning, your zeal for me, so that I rejoiced even more.
So while I was depressed, Titus came to me and told me that you care. Titus told me that you long to see me. Titus told me that you have a zeal for me. So now it's mutual. Because while I'm enduring affliction, the affliction that I'm enduring winds up being your strength. Because you see what I'm going through and it becomes a blessing to you. But then when I'm feeling weary, and after you've been motivated, strengthened by God, you then in return come back and comfort me. So what you have is a never-ending cycle of ministry, comfort, mercy, grace, because that's how God works. It's the same thing in Real fast, let's go to 1 Thessalonians. Real fast, 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. It's the same thing because, saints, this is a powerful principle that while we're enduring everything we're enduring, God's strengthening me to deal with it. God's using my afflictions to minister to you. God's strengthening you to come back and encourage me to keep going. It's like a cycle of ministry. That's why you can't make it without the body of Christ. You can't make it without the body. Because when you realize the effect your testimony has on the lives of those around you, it makes you want to keep serving God. When you come back to me and you say, Brother Jacques, everything you're going through is strengthening me, then while you're testifying to me about how what I'm going through, which felt like I wanted to die, then while I felt like I wanted to die, I'm coming to find out that my death is working life in you. Then you come back and tell me that it strengthens me to want to keep on pressing. Saints, God knows what he's doing. That's why you got to be vocal about your testimony. You got to be vocal about when people are blessing you, because people got to hear it. Because when you don't go back and tell them that they're blessing you, that God's using them to strengthen you, then you're robbing them from their strength. We just got to be honest and open and just be a blessing to one another. Real fast, 1 Thessalonians chapter 3. I'll be quick here. Paul wanted to go to the church at Thessalonica to minister to them, but he wasn't able to because of the affliction he was enduring. Okay? Notice that that's kind of setting it up. So we'll move quick here. 1 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 1.
Therefore, when we could endure it no longer, we thought it best to be left behind at Athens alone.
So therefore, when we couldn't endure the trial, the affliction any longer, we felt it best that we just stay in Athens alone. And Titus and the rest of the ministers, Timothy, just go on without us. Pretty much, we'll bear this by ourselves. You guys save yourselves. Talk about love, amen? Keep coming, notice this.
And we sent Timothy, our brother, and God's fellow worker in the gospel of Christ, to strengthen and encourage you as to your faith, so that no one would be disturbed by these afflictions. Amen. For you yourselves know that we have been destined for this.
You yourselves know that we have been destined for these afflictions. That's what Paul is saying. Now notice what he goes on to say.
For indeed, when we were with you, we kept telling you in advance that we were going to suffer affliction. And so it came to pass, as you know. For this reason, when I could endure it no longer, I also sent to find out about your faith.
For this reason, when I could endure it no longer. This man was honest. He said, for this reason, when I felt like I just need to quit, I sent to find out about your faith. When I felt like I wanted to give up on my faith, I sent someone to find out about your faith. That's powerful. Notice what it goes on to say.
For fear that the tempter might have tempted you and our labor would be in vain.
For fear that the same discouragement that's being worked in me is also being worked in you. I wanted to find out about what you were going through to see if you were as bad off as I was. Notice this.
But now that Timothy has come to us from you and has brought us good news of your faith and love and that you always think kindly of us, longing to see us just as we also long to see you. For this reason, brethren, in all our distress and affliction, we were comforted about you through your faith.
Saints, it's a blessing to know that somebody else is still fighting a good fight of faith. When you feel like you're going to give up and you know your brothers and sisters are enduring the same thing and they come back and testify to you that, yes, I'm going through it, but God is strengthening me, it makes me want to keep pressing. Paul, who felt like he was ready to give up, it then changed his whole mindset to where now he has comfort and joy. Because that's what your testimony can do for the lives of those that are around you. It can help bring them from a bad state to a good state just by you testifying. I thank God for the body of Christ. Saints, we got to keep being strong. We got to keep testifying. We got to keep serving God. We got to make sure we let our brothers and sisters know that God is using them to be a blessing in our lives. Hallelujah. Would you help me stand this morning? Would you help me pray for just a minute? I thank God for his word, saints. God wants us as a body to keep pressing, to keep striving, and demonstrate love to one another. Minister to one another. Appreciate one another. Amen? Because I promise you, saints, when you're feeling down and you feel like you can't make it, the testimony of the righteous will lift you up. We're not going to trust in ourselves. We trust in God who raises the dead, saints. I thank God. Help me pray right now. Father, we thank you for your goodness. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your mercy, Father. And we first and foremost want to thank you, God. We thank you, Father. We magnify you, Father, for your truth. We magnify you for your word, Lord God. We thank you, Father, for we understand that we will endure hardships. We'll endure affliction. We'll endure trials, Lord. But we're not going to trust in ourselves, Father. We'll trust in you, for you are capable of raising the dead, Lord. I thank you for my brothers and sisters, that you minister life, that you minister strength, that you minister hope into them when they need it, God. That you minister comfort unto them when they need it, God. Because you understand that the testimony, Lord, that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony, God. So I pray that you strengthen my brothers, that they might strengthen me. I pray that you lift up my brothers, that they might lift one another up. I pray that you lift up my sisters, that they might lift one another up, God. I pray for those that are weak. I pray that you strengthen them by might in the inner man, Lord. I pray that you strengthen them even by your spirit, that while they're enduring life, while they're enduring afflictions, God, I pray that you raise them up and you lift them up, Lord, that they might continue living righteous and continue living holy before you, Lord God. I pray your strength upon your body to continue fighting the good fight of faith, Lord God. That we might finish this race that you've set before us, Lord God. That we might continue pressing toward the mark of the high calling that's in Christ Jesus, Father. We thank you for this calling, and we thank you for your strength, God. We magnify you for your strength, Lord. We thank you for your comfort, Lord, and we thank you for your mercy, for you truly are the God of all mercy and the God of all comfort. Hallelujah, Father. We receive your comfort. We receive your mercy in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you receive his word, saints, won't you give God a hand clap of praise?
Amen. I thank God for his word this morning. Powerful word. Elder Waldron reminded us that we're blessed. And Elder Franko reminded us that we serve the God of all comfort. Amen. Testify to your neighbor right now and tell them, be comforted this morning. Be comforted. Encourage somebody else as well while you're at it. Be comforted today. We serve the God of all comfort in all situations. He's providing comfort. Sometimes it's through one another. A lot of times it's through one another. Amen. Thank God for his word. I'm encouraged this morning because of this. Let's give him one more hand clap of praise for his word. Thank you, Father. Thank you for your goodness and your mercy to reach down to us this morning, to touch us and encourage us, to uplift us and increase our faith. Hallelujah. To you be all praise and glory and honor, God. Hallelujah.